constant forevermore. You're exalted and still adored. You have always been, you will always be. You surrendered in victory. You are in.
Marvelous, yeah. Yeah. Well, good. We're going to start the service off singing a few songs, a few worship songs. The first one really is, all of this is the reason we're here, but we're here because the gospel unites us as family. I consider each and every one of you my family. We're going to sing and remind each other of what the gospel is and what that should do to our hearts, and just ask God that he'd shine his light on the darkest places in our hearts and change our hearts and bring us closer to him, closer to one another. So let's stand and let's sing together.
Father, come and meet us here as you're casting out all fear. In your love we come alive, oh God. And we'll glorify your name with our lives we will proclaim. In your love we come alive, oh God. for there is no greater love than what God has done when he gave his only son, paid the price for us. And we darkness, your glorious light will shine. Rising on redemption's wings, for forever we will sing. By your truth we are set free, oh God. For we
God, we thank you for what you've done, for what you've done for us. God, we pray that that your love and your light would reign in our hearts. God, that your word would reign in our hearts, that your spirit would reign in our hearts and in our lives. God, we need you. We need your love to define us. We need the life of Jesus to refine us. God, this is our prayer this morning, that you would reign in our hearts, that you would be Lord of our lives. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
You thought of us before the world began to breathe. You knew our names before we came to be. You saw the very day we'd fall away from you, and how desperately we'd need to be redeemed. Lord Jesus, come lead us. We're desperate for your touch. Oh, great and mighty one, with one desire we come, that you would reign, that you would reign in us. We're offering up our lives, a living sacrifice, that you would reign, that you would reign in us. Spirit of
continue to sing, declaring that Christ is enough for us. Enough for me, Christ Let that be the cry of our hearts. That Christ would be exalted in our lives, and that Jesus would be enough for us. Father, we pray this morning that you'd take away all the idols, take away everything that comes before you. God, remove it. Remove it from our lives so that we can see you and see you for who you truly are.
Jesus.
soldiers watched in vain was borrowed for 3 days. His body there would not remain. Our God has robbed the grave. Our God has robbed the
Please remain standing for this morning's scripture reading.
What an absolute joy to sing praises to the Lord. What a joy to hear from the word of the Lord. I'm going to be reading out of John 1:29. Please follow along if you'd like. The next day we saw Jesus coming toward him and said, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I said, 'After me comes a man who ranks before me, because he was before me.' I myself did not know him, but for this purpose I came baptizing with water, that he might be revealed to Israel. And John bore witness. I saw the Spirit descend from heaven like a dove, and it remained on him. I myself did not know him, but he who sent me to baptize with water said to me, 'He on whom you see the Spirit descend and remain, this is he who baptizes with the Holy Spirit.' And I have seen and I have bore witness that this is the Son of God." Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. Well, good morning. Am I on this morning? Sounds like I am. It is good to worship together once again this morning. I think I should introduce myself. I'm Pastor Gary. Many of you don't recognize me. Thank you so much. That, I think, is the first time in God's church I have actually ever heard that. May it never happen again. No, it's good. It's a Let me just give you a little scoop. Contrary to popular belief, I do have other clean things in my closet that I could have worn this morning. So it was not the only clean thing in my closet. So just get that taken care of. This morning is a great day to have a wedding. And many of you know Terrence Hudson and Katie Eastridge. They are joining together in holy matrimony this afternoon. So if you don't see the rest of the Hudson crew, and maybe even the Wilsons and others that are family related, you know where they're at. They're down at a beautiful vineyard about an hour south of here, and we have a wedding this afternoon. I get the privilege of officiating. It's exciting to see what God's doing in that young couple's lives, and we're going to share the gospel with a number of folks. And just for fun, if you want to come be a wedding crasher, just let me know. I'll give you the address. No, probably shouldn't do that. But anyway, so I wanted to just disclaim why I have a suit on. And if you want that more often, please see me. And no, really don't. Let the cards and emails come. All right, I'll just get it out this morning right off the get-go. Congratulations, Hawkeyes. That's all you got? Something tells me you either lost your voice yesterday because you were yelling, or something. Okay, Cyclones, how you doing? Yeah, right. You know, you should be proud, Lynn. That's right. It was a well-fought game, and you know, you gotta love games that come down to the very end. And you go, okay, who is going to win this thing, and who's going to get that final score that puts them over the top? Kind of fun. And I thank the Lord for the joy of sports, to enjoy something like that. I praise the Lord even for, you know, little in-state rivalries. Some of you who might be new to the in-state rivalry are going, what? It's good. It's good, and it's a fun thing. We celebrate that. We have fun with that. We should never certainly really be disunified as God's church, ultimately, over that. But this morning, as we come to the Word, I want us to be reminded that those are great things. Games like that are great things. And they provide entertainment for us and some fun for us, don't they? But we have to recognize where our focus really, truly needs to be. It's fun to enjoy something like that, like sports. I'm an avid Dallas Cowboy fan. Don't hold that against me. Right? Please. Well, you can if you want. We should probably talk. But you know what? That's not the apple of my eye. Jesus Christ is the apple of my eye. And this morning, as we dive into John's gospel, we're going to see another person. Many of us might be familiar with him. Many call him John the Baptist, or I like to call him John the Baptizer. You know what? Many people put a big focus on John the Baptizer in their day. But it'll be fun as we dive into this text today to recognize what John the Baptizer actually does. He, and I'll just give you a little hint, you'll see it as we go through it, he always bounces that conversation away from himself back to where the eyes need to be focused, specifically upon Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Now, if you've been on the Christian journey for some portion of your time in your life, you will certainly, I'm sure, agree with me that from time to time throughout the entirety of the Scriptures, we come across what we might call as truly monumental events throughout the pages of Scripture. The type of monumental events that seem to change everything. And I would propose to you this morning that the text that we're entering into is one of those very monumental events that we all need to stand up and take notice of this morning. In fact, I will propose to you this morning that the very text we're going to study from John 1, 29 through 34, I'd invite you to turn in your Bibles or your apps with us. It is paramount and it is absolutely monumental because it is the official launch. It's the official public launch of Jesus' public ministry. And who launches it is nonetheless John the Baptizer. Now, if you remember from last week, if you were able to join us, or if you weren't, I'll give you a little context here. Last week when Ryan shared this text, remember that oftentimes the priests and the Levites, they were coming to John the Baptizer saying, "So, dude, tell us who you are. Tell us who you are. Are you another prophet? Are you Elijah? Are you the Christ? "Who are you, John the Baptist?" And he would faithfully, faithfully bounce that. And he'd say, "Look, let the subject of your eyes be on the one who is far greater than I myself." And now today, we get to see, as we approach verse 29, we get to see in verse 29, it starts off this way. The next day. So what we read last week and studied last week, in essence, this is the very next day that we're approaching. And here's what happens. The very next day, he saw Jesus coming toward him. The very next day, John saw Jesus coming towards him. And I want us to not miss it this morning, and it's a huge key element to the Gospel of John and to our text for today, and it is simply this. John, full of the Holy Spirit, when he sees Jesus coming towards him, listen to what he could say. This is all that he could get out. Ready? "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." Wow. "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." Now, inside of that declaration by John, there's two very important pieces that he's presenting to those that were his hearers of that day, and ultimately for you and I as well. I believe the first thing that he's presenting to us is the person of God. Secondly, I believe he's presenting the work of God. The person of God, and secondly, the work of God. Now in our culture today, when we hear the words, "Behold the Lamb of God," that statement for us today in North America doesn't come anywhere close to what the original audience would have heard. It doesn't make a lot of sense unless we grew up maybe in the church to understand what it meant with the sacrificial lamb or what John might have meant with the Lamb of God. That's for those of us who have been church. But for much of this world, if we stood outside and declared, "Behold the Lamb of God," most of this world would just keep on a walking on by, and it would make probably no sense to any of them. But you see, in John's day, the conversation about lamb or the sacrificial lamb was kind of a commonplace conversation in their day-to-day life. And I'm going to talk a little bit more about that in a moment, but let's first start with the person of God. These first two things, the person of God and the work of God that's declared in John's statement in verse 29, these, my friends, I believe are central to the gospel. First, what John is declaring is, this is who God is. God is before us in human form. I mean, you may remember a couple weeks ago we talked about in John 1:14, "And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. We have seen His glory." It's the incarnate God was right there, and John is standing up and saying, "Look, you need to understand who God is. This is Jesus, who is fully God, and He is here in person." And then he doesn't stop there. He says, not only is this declaring who God is right before us, but what He came to earth to complete. These two aspects of the gospel, I believe, are the first two aspects that we need to understand as Christ followers today. Who is God? And what has He come to earth to do? So let's talk a little bit about who God is. John declared, "And behold the Lamb of God." What does it mean when we say the Lamb of God? Notice that nowhere in our text for today does John even really try to explain that terminology to his audience or to us. He doesn't spend any time saying, "When I say Lamb of God, this is what I mean." Why? Because the term of Lamb of God was commonplace for the audience. Now, that's at that time. Now, for us today, if you've spent any time in the Scriptures, especially coming through the Old Testament, what you will find is that the background, you'll come to realize that the background of the whole Old Testament, that there is a understanding and a communication regularly through the Old Testament that helps us to understand this whole concept of sacrificial Lamb of God. In fact, out of the entire images in the Old Testament, I would propose to us today that the number one most prominent image in the Old Testament was the sacrificial lamb. The sacrificial lamb whose blood, when it was poured out for the remission of sins. Now, possibly the most well-known lamb in the Scriptures could be that of the Passover lamb. If you're not familiar with it, just kind of listen along, and I'd invite you this week in your quiet time to get into Exodus 12 and understand, read and understand more about the Passover lamb. But Exodus 12 tells us of how God delivered his people from the angel of death in Egypt that came through and killed the firstborn in every home. That is, except for the ones who had obeyed God's voice. You see, God's people, the Israelites, were offered a way out from such death. And the way that God provided for his people away from such death was that each individual household was to sacrifice a lamb. And when they sacrificed that lamb, the instruction with that was to take the blood that was sacrificed out of that lamb and pour it out over the doorposts of their homes. So that when the angel of death would sweep through, that angel of death, God would preserve those where the blood had been poured out, and it preserved God's people from death. So we often call it the Passover, because the angel of death passed over those and did not affect those that were protected by the blood. Hence the word Passover. You know, there's many, many connections between the Old Testament and Jesus as the Passover lamb. I wish we had time enough this morning to actually talk through all the many connectors we see throughout the Old Testament that come to reality in Jesus as the Passover lamb. Probably one of the greatest connectors to the Passover lamb is related directly to when Jesus was presented in front of the people. You see, the day that Jesus was handed over to be killed and to have his blood poured out on the cross, that, Scripture tells us, was called Preparation Day for the Passover. Let me read a little snippet for you out of John 19, verses 14 through 16. I believe we'll have it on the screen as well. Now, it was the day of the preparation of the Passover. It was about the sixth hour, which we would understand as being noon today. And he said to the Jews, "Behold the king." And they cried out, "Away with him, away with him, crucify him." And Pilate said to them, "Shall I crucify your king?" And the chief priests answered, "We have no king but Caesar." So he delivered him over to them to be crucified. Now imagine this with me, if you will. The very day, the very time where Jesus was being presented in front of the people, that very day, in that very city, the sacrificial lamb was being picked to be killed for its blood to be poured out. And so it was, the ultimate sacrificial lamb, Jesus Christ, on preparation day for the Passover, was also being picked to be the sacrificial lamb for you and for me. And so when John declares in our text for this morning, and he says, "Behold the Lamb of God," it was John's way of saying, look, here is the one whose blood is about to be poured out for the forgiveness of sins. So why? Why? Why was that to be so? Because there had to be one ultimate sacrifice worthy of God to satisfy the wrath against sin in this world, the wrath of God upon the sin of the world. There had to be one that was ultimately capable. Another way of saying this is that those who have obeyed God's voice and placed their faith in the shed blood of Jesus as the Lamb of God, one day we have the privilege of being passed over from death until life. We will not experience eternal death and damnation, but rather we will experience incredible eternal life in the presence of our King. Now, where I came from, that required an amen. You don't have to. Let the Lord lead you. But I'm here to tell you, think about it. Think of the privilege that we have of being passed over from death unto life by faith in Jesus Christ. Now, that isn't the only mention of lambs in the Old Testament. In the Old Testament, you have to recognize that lambs were being slaughtered, were being killed every day, morning and evening. The killing of a sacrificial lamb was an ongoing reminder for man at that time of God's people to recognize their depravity and their need for a sacrifice that is worthy for God to accept. And think about it. As John the Baptizer, when he sees Jesus coming towards him and he declares, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world," when he was declaring those very words, a lamb was being slaughtered on an altar for the remission of sins. You know, there's another connection that John may be making here. I love the prophet Isaiah's words, and Isaiah 53 comes to mind. Isaiah 53, 6 and 7 says this, "All we like sheep have gone astray. We've turned our own way. The Lord has laid on him we now understand, being Jesus Christ. So he has laid on him, Jesus, the iniquities of us all. He was oppressed, he was afflicted, yes, he opened not his mouth." Catch this. "Like a lamb that is led to slaughter, like a sheep that before its shears is silent, so he opened not his mouth." I have no doubt that John was probably thinking of Isaiah's prophecy as he declared, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world." You might even think about some of the other lamb stories, if you will, throughout Scripture. One that might come to mind to you this morning, it comes out of Genesis 22. We're going to get to that in a number of weeks as we go back to our series in Genesis here in a few weeks. But in Genesis 22, you may remember the story of Abraham and how God wanted to test Abraham's faith. And so what God, you know, told Abraham to do was to go sacrifice his son Isaac. And so what happens is God's testing Abraham's faith, and he commands him to take his son like a lamb and sacrifice him. Abraham immediately obeys, and he takes off on that three-day journey to the land of Moriah. And as Isaac, now I want to break a little bit of Sunday school theology. I grew up as a young boy thinking that Isaac was probably just a young little 5, 6, 7, 8-year-old boy. That was kind of the Sunday school theology that I was taught. My friends, historically, it looks more like Isaac was probably a strapping young guy. He might have been in his early 20s or so, as far as we can tell. So he was probably very capable to haul the wood that Genesis 22 says he was hauling the wood for the sacrifice. And if you know that story at all, here's Abraham and Isaac, and Abraham stops and leaves a couple of the other helpers behind, and Isaac takes the wood. He probably strapped it on his back or something, or maybe he's carrying it. And he looks over at his father, Abraham, and he says, you can just imagine, can't you? "Dad, I got the wood. Dad, man, you got the fire. Dad, you got the knife. But you remember what he asked? Where's the lamb? Where's the sacrificial lamb that is supposed to be offered?" Now, Scripture is silent about this, but it makes, you know, makes me wonder if Abraham didn't look at him and say, "Well, son, here's what God said. You are the lucky winner today. Now, Scripture doesn't tell us that, but I love what Scripture does tell us of Abraham's faith and Abraham's response to his son in Genesis 22:8. Here's what he said. He said, God will provide for himself the lamb. God will provide for himself the lamb. In fact, I would promote to us this morning that if we could sum up the entire statement or question of the Old Testament into the New, it would sound like this. Ready? Where is the Lamb of God that will take away the sins of the world? Where is he? Where is the Lamb? Where is he? I think both Abraham's answer to his son and John the Baptizer's statement about Jesus was true, that God will provide for himself the Lamb, and God has provided the Lamb of God for himself. Behold the Lamb of God that has taken away the sins of the world. Do you realize that statement right here in verse 29 by John the Baptizer is probably the answer, is not probably, it is the greatest, it's the answer for the greatest need of the entire world to this day. John wraps it up in one simple statement. John, full of the Holy Spirit, he could hold nothing back. All he could say is, look, here's the declaration. Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Here's my question for you this morning. Do you declare these truths as boldly as John the Baptizer did? You know, last week, Ryan made the comment, and I would agree with this comment. He said, you know, our country, our world, much of our world, have become a consumer-focused people. Consumerism has taken them over, and unfortunately, all too much, that consumerism bleeds itself right into the church. You've probably heard it as I have. I want church this way. I want these things my way. I mean, who is it? Burger King, McDonald's, whoever it is that you get your way, right? That kind of goofed up theology has found its way infiltrated into the church so that the church is somehow about me. My friends, that's wrong. We have unfortunately become so inward focused. We have our eyes on the wrong things. We've got our eyes off of God, and we're asking a whole lot about ourselves. I think we need to turn. I think we need to repent and come back and say, look, where is our focus supposed to be? And I would promote to you this morning, it ought to sound like this. Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Now be aware that as we look at our text this morning, there are parts of our world that take verse 29 and twist it for their own good. I've heard people even tell me, look, see, verse 29 says that the Lamb of God took care of the sins of the world, so I'm good. I'm in. He took care of it. It's all done. They don't bother to consider the rest of Scripture to understand truly the meaning of verse 29. But I'm going to boil it down for us this morning with two key words and a follow-up question. And these are some of the words you learn in seminary. One is sufficiency. Second is efficacy. These are cool words, so over lunch you can go ahead and throw these around because you'll understand the meaning of them here in a moment. The sufficiency and the efficacy of the cross of Jesus Christ. And the question is Jesus' death on the cross sufficient for the salvation of all people? Ask yourself that question. Do you understand the sufficiency of the cross of Christ? Here it is. Is the cross of Christ sufficient for the salvation of all men, women, and children who have ever lived and ever will live? The absolute answer according to Scripture is yes. Yes. But then we come to the word efficacy. And you have to wrestle that one down and go, the cross is sufficient for all. Doesn't matter what you've done. But is it effective? Who is it effective for? And I think it doesn't take us but a second to turn about a page or two in your Bibles to John 3:16. And John's gospel gives us the answer for who the cross is actually effective for. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world, he gave his only Son, whosoever, so that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." Or the ESV says, eternal life. So yes, God so loved the world, he gave his Son, Jesus Christ. The sufficiency of the cross is there before us, but it is only effective, my friends, for those who believe in his name as the Lord and Savior of their life. They are the ones that pass from this life to the next into the eternal presence of God. So is Jesus' death sufficient for the world? Absolutely. But it is only effective for whoever believe in him. You know, it begs the question, why did John write the entire Gospel of John? I think it's for that very reason. He tells us. Sometimes the biblical authors tell us why they wrote a letter. Why John wrote this gospel? It's worth writing down. He tells us specifically in John 20, verse 31. He says this, "But these are written," in other words, the gospel of John is written, "so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. His death as the Lamb of God is wholly sufficient for you, no matter what you've done, but it is only effective for those who repent of their sin and turn to Jesus for eternal life." Now, before we move on, it's amazing how long a pastor can talk on one verse, isn't it? Before we move on, I want to give you a few nuggets out of the Old Testament that are just kind of fun, and you'll see those as you continue to be students of the Word. First of all, you may remember in the sacrificial lamb understanding, in Abraham's day, it was required that a lamb was given for each person. For example, Isaac. But then as you continue on and see your way through the Old Testament, by the time we get to the Passover, what Scripture shows us is that there is one lamb that is sacrificial, and it's worthy of covering the entire family. Remember the blood on the doorposts? So you kind of see the sequence, right? And then we get to see in the Old Testament, eventually, a sacrificial lamb was sufficient to cover for the sins of an entire nation. But then we cross the bridge into the New Testament, or oftentimes called the New Covenant. And what we get to see in the New Covenant is the most amazing thing, and that is this, that there is one sacrificial lamb, Jesus Christ, who is sufficient. His sacrifice is sufficient for the entire world by faith. My friends, Jesus, the Lamb of God alone is worthy. Jesus, the Lamb of God alone is able. Jesus, the Lamb of God he is God. Jesus, the Lamb of God, bore your sins on the cross that you might have life. Jesus alone is the Lamb of God who has taken away the sins of the world. Am I fired up this morning? I think this has been pent up inside. My friends, I think we got our eyes focused on the wrong stuff. And we ought to repent. In need to get our eyes focused on the Lamb of God. It takes away the sins of the world. Now, last week, Ryan talked briefly in verse 27 about how John declares Jesus' total superiority, his total supremacy, if you will. You know, catch what John said last week. He said, look, I'm not even worthy. You could almost say it this way. I'm not even worthy to touch the sandal, the tie on Jesus' sandal. I'm not worthy. John continues that very thing this morning in verse 30 when he says this. He goes, after me comes a man who ranks before me. Why? Because he was before me. He ranks before me. Why? Because this man, Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, has always existed. So John says, look, stop talking about me. Stop looking at me. I'm not a prophet. I'm not Elijah. I'm not the Christ. Folks, you need to understand. Stop looking at John and start looking at the Lamb of God and start talking about the Lamb of God, because he is far greater, John says, than he himself. Jesus alone is the one who takes away the sins of the world. Friends, I think we're all susceptible to fall into the trap of focusing on other people, aren't we? We're focused on him and her and these and that and all this other stuff. And people are important. They are important to God. I want you to know that, because the one thing that passes from this life to the next is what? People. Yes, we need to be on mission. But we can't be on mission when we're all worried about what he's saying or he's doing or she's doing. My friends, in fact, we have a problem in the church today. You know what it is? We idolize pastors. Please don't idolize any pastor. They are a human, just like I put my pants on the same way you all do every day. I'm just as much as a sinner. I feel like Paul. I'm the worst of them all. But we need to stop idolizing, like they were trying to figure out who John was. We need to stop focusing on who's up here. You know what? This, when we founded Timberline, the one of the main focuses was that we will raise up pastors. We will raise up leaders in God's church. And you know what? A lot of times they're going to goof up. They're not going to be perfectly spoken. They're not going to have all the graces of some of those, you know, those big public figures of pastors. You know what? So what? It ain't about any leader in this church. Our focus, the focus on our eyes, we must repent if our focus has not been on what God is doing and what he has done through Jesus Christ. It's what we need to be doing, my friends. Focus it back on the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. John says it, look, I'm basically saying I'm nobody. I only baptize with water. But then he says, but look at Jesus. Man, he baptizes with the Holy Spirit. And then John continues on. He says, look, he baptizes the Holy Spirit. John says, I saw the Spirit of God descend upon Jesus. John, this incredible missionary, we know from Scripture he was filled with the Holy Spirit from the time he was actually in the womb of his mama. This man, filled with the Holy Spirit, had the eyes that we all need to have. He was not focused about his agenda, he was focused about Jesus' agenda. If full of the Holy Spirit, he says, look, I can see where the Holy Spirit's working. I can see where the Holy Spirit came down upon Jesus and clarified that this is the Lamb of God. He is full deity right before John. He's declaring. Do we have eyes like John the Baptizer this morning? If the Spirit of God is in us, do we have eyes like John the Baptizer, where we can see where the Spirit of God is working and we can get in step with the Spirit? Where we can declare when we could see the Spirit of God moving in a person's life, we could say, look, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world, and you go declare the gospel to that person because you could see the Spirit of God cracking in, trying to reach that man, woman, or child. Or my friends, this morning, are we too stinking distracted with the garbage of this life and our self-indulgent lives that we don't know, we don't even see where the Spirit's working, and we don't even bother to ever in our entire lives even declare to anybody who Jesus is? May that never be said of us. May it never be said that we don't care about our neighbors next door in an apartment. May it never be said that we have not gone door to door, next door, at our work, behind our house, wherever we are. May it never be said that we don't declare Him. May it be said of us that we will be brave. We will be bold, but yet we will be gentle to declare Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. So what is God asking of you this morning? What is He asking? If you're a non-believer this morning, if you came in here and you could not declare for your own self who Jesus was in your life, I believe that if John the Baptizer was standing right before me, I believe he would have these words, probably a lot more than what I'm about to say, but I believe he would probably say something like this: behold the Lamb of God, Jesus Christ, who takes away the sins of the world. Do you know Him? Do you know Him? And if you don't, and He's being revealed to you this morning, that's the Spirit of God that is trying to crack in your life. And I would invite you to repent of your sin and turn to Him as the author of your life and the creator of your eternal life. He is the one who is your Redeemer. And begin to learn what it means to walk in His righteousness for the rest of the days you have breath in your lungs. I believe John would say that with probably a lot more while he's eating his locust and eating his honey. Ick, right? Love honey. Locust? Never tried it. For those of us who came this morning who say we are believers, who is God calling you to reach? Where do you see the Spirit of God? Maybe you need to start by getting rid of some distractions in your life. Say, I'm okay if I don't have those distractions. I want to put my focus back on where my focus should be, declaring Jesus to the lost and dying world around us. Where do you see the Spirit working? Partner with the Spirit of God. Partner with Him and declare those beautiful words: behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Now here at Timberline, we have the privilege of partnering with a number of missionaries. So you might see that on our budget, and so corporately through some of our giving, a portion of that is allotted to different missionaries both locally and across the globe. And this morning we have the privilege of hearing briefly from a young couple. I'm going to invite Israel and Sarah to come on up. Some of you know them, but we have been partnering as a body for the last couple of years with Israel and Sarah Quintani. And they come to us from the country of Portugal. And I want us as a body to get to know this great young couple. I've known this guy since he was about that tall, as I recall, when we helped partner with a church that his father helped plant in South Brazil. It's a great family. Love this family. He married up. I'm just going to tell you that. So as much as I love him, Sarah is an unbelievable blessing to this man. As they share with us this morning, I've asked them to share a little bit about their story and about their ministry and where they are seeing the Spirit of God working in their lives and where they are partnering, where the Spirit is moving. As they share this morning, I want each and every one of us to be asking these questions of ourselves. How do we, either as a family or as an individual, partner with Israel and Sarah more in the time ahead. Maybe it's where you put them on your daily prayer time. Maybe you individually partner with them financially, above and beyond. Maybe God will be calling somebody here to be an international full-time missionary over in Portugal to partner with Israel and Sarah. They would certainly welcome that. Or maybe God may call you up at some point to go on some of the short-term mission teams we would like to be sending in the time ahead. Ask the Lord to reveal to himself to you this morning, how does God want you to partner alongside of them? So Israel and Sarah, the floor is yours. Take the next few minutes. Just tell us a little bit about yourself, and we look forward to hearing what God's doing in your life, all right?
Thank you so much, Pastor Gary. Good morning, church. It is really a great privilege for us to be here, and we really thank you for you being so welcome to us. And we've been really praying for this moment, because this is something very special for us, and this is really a great part of our ministry too, which is really sharing what the Lord is doing in our midst. So the first question would be, where did all started? And I'll tell you, it all started in the next slide, which would be 1987, when I was born. That's how it started, basically. And so that's embarrassing, but okay, that's me. And that's me when I was 8, I was getting baptized. So I was born in a Christian home. My parents were pastors at a church. So I grew up as a pastor's kid and always being involved in missions or mission trips. And really, every time that missions would come to church, my heart would start pounding harder and harder, because that was something that was growing in me. And not just in a normal way as, okay, missions is interesting, but something like, that's what I want to do. And so that's just me very excited about missions. And then I finished college. I did biology back in Brazil. So I lived until I was 23 years old. Right after college, the Lord opened up the door for me to go to Portugal. And that's where I found Sarah, and that's how we met. And then I started theology, my biology theology degree. And if you're wondering how everything started, or our connection with Timberline, everything started here 15 years ago. Pastor Gary, that's you. And this is me. And since 15 years ago, two things have not changed. Number one, Pastor Gary's beautiful hair. Number two, the passion and the desire to serve the Lord and serve others. This the Lord has kept in my heart. And I'll give now that you can share your story.
So my story is a little bit different. I was also born in Brazil, but at 2.5 years, I was 2.5 in that picture. My parents left Brazil to serve as missionaries in India, so I spent most of my childhood there. That's an important picture in my family because it was just taken a few days before we left Brazil, so it was an important transition for us. After about 8.5 years there, we had to leave for various reasons, and we spent some time back in Brazil, and then we went to Portugal, actually, where I spent most of my teenage years. So I've actually been living there for quite a number of years now. I got to go to college in England, and when I came back, like Israel said, he grew up with a desire for mission in his heart, and so did I. I came to Christ through a Salty tape. Are you familiar with Salty, the singing songbook? There was a song that said, God has a plan for your life. I just can't wait to see what's in store for me because God has a plan for my life. So I was like, this is too exciting not to be a part of. And so I just gave my life to Christ when I was 6 years old in India. And I was kind of like waiting to see how that would develop. And I thought, well, I'm out of college now, and this is going to be the exciting time in my life where I get to go to the ends of the earth and do something exciting for God. But I pursued some different opportunities, and nothing really panned out the way I had imagined. And at the time, I was also reading a devotional for people who had gone through different transitions. And it's the title of the devotional was Bloom Where You Are Planted, and it was calling us to unpack our bags and settle down where we were and look for opportunities to serve God and sow seeds, because even if we didn't see them develop to their fullest, someone else would. And so that's kind of when my attitude changed a little bit towards Portugal. I met Israel in 2010. I had just graduated. It was not love at first sight. Just kidding. No, Israel had a goatee. It was really long and weird. And no, that was not. Yeah, we started talking, and then in 2011 we started having a relationship, and then in 2012 we got engaged, and we had the opportunity to come to the U.S. and meet some of you, and the shoemakers, our co-workers, invited us to be part of a church planning project, and so that's where we've been for the last 4 years, and yeah, we've been married that long too.
Thank you. Yes, I shaved. It was very important. And so I've been asking pretty much my whole life, Lord, you've put this desire in my heart to be serving you. Where do you want me to go, and what do you want me to be doing? Basically, I was asking the same question that Pastor Gary just asked us today. And I was in Portugal, and those answers were not very clear to me. But halfway through a Bible degree in 2012, as Sarah shared, we were invited to be part of this church planting. And that's how the Lord answered our prayers. So the Lord called us to be in Portugal, really sharing the gospel and saying to the Portuguese people, behold, this is the Lamb of the Lord. So this is Portugal. We're the western part of Europe. We're living in the outskirts of Lisbon. Really, a third of the population is living there. And the next slide would show us a little bit of how and what Portuguese culture looks like, or what is the background. It's really a sad, blinded religious background. So Portuguese are very Catholic. It's a traditionally Roman Catholic, and being Portuguese means Catholic, and you really can't separate those things. But the sad thing is to see how people are blinded by religion, that really blind them to see the truth of the gospel. And so this is really what we're doing there. And the next slide would then lead us to what we're doing, what church planting is about. You've been studying the book of John, and so I like this verse very much because it summarizes a lot of what really the incarnational ministry of Jesus is. He became one of us. He became flesh and blood and wealth and really moved into the neighborhood. It's very interesting. If Jesus was here today, he would probably be wearing just shirts and shorts and be less formal than Pastor Gary is today. But really, probably, drinking coffee and hanging out with us and preaching the powerful message of the gospel. This is what we try and humbly try to do. And the next slide, so that would show us really what we tried to do. As soon as we got married, we moved into that neighborhood that had no church for Portuguese. Really no church. Portugal has 0.6% of evangelical Christians. So that area that we moved in, there was no church for Portuguese. And so we really started to get involved in as many possible associations as we could, as time allowed it to. And really, each one of those circles have one specific story. But the main purpose of each one of those involvements throughout the week, those are kind of weekly activities that we do. The purpose of it is really trying to reach out people and really try to find who is God working in their hearts. Like, who is God working in? Because we really try to find people of peace. And the question is, how can we best be part of what God is already doing in these people's lives? And so as soon as we identify those people who God has been working their hearts, we would be inviting them to come to our Bible studies. And the next slide would show us one example of what God has, or one of the doors that the Lord has opened to us, which would be this association that I've been working is with. This picture in your left is really the first time that I started telling Bible stories for kids. And this is how it happened. I started serving there and really doing tutoring in this local association. I really started just loving and serving those people. As soon as, the coordinator of that association, she recognized that there was something different. And of course, she found out that we were Christians. We clearly said that. And as soon as she found out that, she came to me and said, you know, Israel, this is after-school program. And so she came to me and said, Israel, those kids have a lot of problems because they come from a very hard background and very unstructured families. And I know that they need faith in order to overcome their difficulties and the challenges that they go through. So she asked me, could you please tell Bible stories to those kids? And I was like, are you kidding me? Of course. And so I really started, you know, ministering and telling Bible stories to those kids in order to take them to the faith in God. And this is something great because every Friday that I would be there, the kids would come to me and say, are you going to tell us a story about Jesus for us today? And I would gladly say, yes, I am. And so this is very interesting. Besides that, I would also be tutoring neighbors, for example. God has really opened the doors for me to go into their house and really start getting to know not just the kids, but also the families.
So Israel started meeting all these kids and families in our neighborhood, and we're like, God is really opening a door here for us. And so what are we going to do with these kids? I mean, they're in high school now, but they're going to be in college soon. How can we best be reaching them? And so we partnered with an organization called Young Life, some of you might be familiar with, and it kind of just caters for the outside kid, the kid who's never been to church, the kid who has no Christian background. And so it's easy to plug our kids into these events because it's natural. They're already like catering to those kids. So one of the highlights of the year is surf camp. We live near the coast, and so we have beautiful beaches, and so we get to do surf camp with the kids. And those two girls up there in the first photo, they ended up in surf camp, I don't know how. Like, these kids, I think the parents just wanted to get rid of them, and they're like just too cool for school, sitting in the back of the room all the time, not wanting to get involved with anything. And I was like, oh man, 7 days with these kids, it's going to be hard. But it was amazing to see what God was doing in their hearts. And this morning we were at Woodlands Creek, is that right? And we sang this song where it said, God can melt the hearts of stone. And that's what I saw with this young lady here. At the beginning of the week, they were just really distant and really in the back and like not wanting to get involved in anything. And then through humor and funny games and silly things that we were all doing, trying to do as leaders to try to get them to bond with us and open up their hearts a little bit, I could see that God was breaking down the barriers. And at the end of the week, through the discussions and small groups, I could see that God was really trying to wrestle with their hearts and have them grasp some of the biblical truths that we were teaching them. And at the end of the week, we do something called a say-so, which is based off of Psalm 107, verse 2, which says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. And we tell kids, if you've given your life to Christ this week, you can have a chance to publicly say that if you want. You can have a chance to share that. And there's no pressure. We try to tell kids that, you know, they can still be a Christian if they don't do this. But so we sing this last song. This is the last day of camp. And the speaker goes, okay, if you want to share something with us about what God has done in your life this week, just please remain standing. And then most of the room sits down. And to my amazement, I look up, and there's Joyce, the lady in the middle there. And she just said, I gave my life to Christ this week. I didn't realize that sin was taking the crown from Jesus and wanting to live my own life. I thought that it was just about rules and things like that and not doing the bad stuff, but I realized that I need to give my life to Jesus. And so that was a really amazing thing, and that's what our prayer is for not only these kids, but their parents and the communities, that God would melt their hearts of stone.
Yeah, the next slide will just show our small Bible study that we have. So far what we're trying to reach out people. And then the last slide will be showing us the main prayer requests. We've got prayer cards. Please be praying for us. And if the Lord has put in your hearts also to be supporting us in prayer financially, may the Lord speak to you. Thank you very much for your support.
Excellent. Thank you. Would you join me in prayer? Yeah, let's give him a round of applause. Absolutely. Come on up, sir. Join me as we go before the Lord. Father, Lord, we love Israel and Sarah. We thank you for their hearts and their lives. We thank you for calling them out, Lord, in a population that less than 1% even knows you. Lord, the work is mind-blowing for us to think. Lord, the need is great, and Lord, it is. We understand that the greatest thing that needs to be declared across this globe is, behold, the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. Lord, we pray that you would continue to bless the work of Israel and Sarah. Lord, we pray that you would just raise up leaders, Lord, who would come alongside of them, not only which is needed in finances and in prayer, Lord, but also those who would be willing to sacrifice of their lives to go and partner with them, that more people can be reached with the gospel of Jesus Christ. So, Father, we pray, Lord, that you would reveal, Lord, these things to them as they go back here to their work very soon. We pray that you would continue to give them eyes like John the Baptizer to see where your Spirit is breaking in, and let them partner with your Spirit, Lord, in amazing ways. And we pray for just an incredible harvest of people like this young lady who recognizes, Lord, her sin stood in the way of a relationship with you. Father, may those words be said many times over, because you've called Israel and Sarah there in Portugal. And Lord, may we also, Lord, as the body of Christ right here in Timberline, recognize our role, whatever that is, wherever that leads us. Father, I pray, Lord, you would reveal it by your Spirit, that you would bring glory to yourself through us. And we pray these things in the powerful and amazing name of Jesus. And all God said, all God's people said, amen. Thanks for sharing, you guys. Well, we're going to close the service. We have a few announcements this morning. By the way, Israel and Sarah, Susan's going to show you to Quest Kids, because they're going to go speak to Quest Kids for a few minutes. And after they're done speaking to Quest Kids, they're going to come back in. Israel and Sarah are going to be by the grand piano. They're one of the 10-minute parties this morning. We actually have two going on this morning. So Israel and Sarah will be back in there. Let me hit a couple of announcements. In the meanwhile, I'm going to invite Max to come up and Joel Jernstad to come up as well. We have a couple. I put the microphone away and I need it. First of all, if you're new with us, if you're a newcomer with us, we invite you next Sunday to join us at noon at Pizza Ranch here in Urbandale. But we would like to know that you're coming. So if you grab your program and open it up and fill that portion out that you're going to join us, tear that off, drop it in the box between the worship center doors today before you leave. We would appreciate, we want to know, we want to set up the room so we have plenty of room for all newcomers to come. All right, it's a great opportunity for you to ask any questions you may have and kind of get next steps of connected if you're interested here at Timberline. Okay, so next week, that's called Newcomers Pizza. Let us know you're coming. First, I'm going to start with Joel. Come here, Joel. I'm going to bring you up first here. Max, you just got to stand there and wait. It's all good. All right, we have two classes that launch 2 weeks from now. 2 weeks from now? Is that possible? Yep. 2 weeks from now, September the 24th. Joel, give us a little 30-second snippet.
Is that 2 minutes?
Give us a minute, 59 seconds. Anyway, there's this. Tell us about Kingdom Life, and if they haven't been part of it, why would they want, what's the big rocks of Kingdom Life class? Yep.
Thank you. So I'm really excited about this class. I always get very excited about the material. Kingdom Life is one of the few classes that I've ever, or anything that I've done in my Christian life, where we really focus on what is right about you. There's a lot of focus on and opportunities, and rightfully so, for us to think about what we need to do better and how we can be more like Christ and what we need to focus on living life better. But Kingdom Life allows us to look into ourselves, understand first who God is as a creator, how he has created us. We spend a lot of time looking inwardly and going through exercises and spending time in scripture, understanding different spiritual gifts that people have, how you feel refreshed spiritually, but also your talents, and allows us to start thinking about, instead of beginning to participate in church activities and ministries where we need to throw bodies at it because we need help desperately, it allows you to start thinking more strategically about really how has God gifted me to make the most impact? Where should I be focusing my time, talent, and treasure? And once you have an understanding of that, it really gives you a lot of freedom to say, I'm not going to get involved here because that's not really a good fit for me. Yes, I can do it. It would be frustrating for me. But where can I be involved? And how can I make the most impact for the kingdom by understanding myself better and that where I can be refreshed and have the most impact?
Excellent, excellent. So it starts at 8:15 on 8:15 till when?
8:15 to 9:45 on Sunday mornings.
September 24 weeks. How many class weeks?
We'll have 8 weeks. So we'll focus a few weeks on making sure we have the right base theology, and then we spend 4 weeks really looking inwardly and doing some of those assessments and talking through, you know, your gifts and talents. And then we spend the last 2 weeks trying to synthesize that and talking about your passions and helping you to think about, based on who I am, where should I be looking to get involved?
Excellent. It's a class, one of my favorites. Don't know why. I do know why. It is good. Joel's going to do a great job teaching it. If you haven't been through it, highly recommend it. Next week will be a 10-minute party out of Missio Day that'll talk more. I'll be actually standing in for you because you have to be gone, I think. I'll stand and answer any questions you might have about Kingdom Life. But today, if you want to grab Joel and ask him questions, grab him. He'll be fellowshipping around here somewhere, so make sure to grab him. Thanks, Joel. All right, Max. Max Godsey, you get to talk about a brand new class here at Timberline. I like to simplify it and call it Foundations. Tell us about the nuggets of Foundations.
Super. I'm so thankful for the Lord using Pastor Gary with such a tremendous message and such a great lead-in for this class. So if we follow the message and we're really focusing on Jesus, I'd like to share with you one of the key scriptures that frames the foundations of the Christian walk, which is starting in 2 weeks. This is from Luke 6, and this is Jesus' words. He says, "Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and not do what I tell you? Everyone who comes to me and hears my words and does them, I will show you who he is like. He is like a man building a house who dug deep and laid the foundation on the rock. And when the flood arose, the stream broke against that house and could not shake it because it had been well built." This course is built for people who have never looked at foundations and for those who have looked many times and are ready to rediscover new depths, because the Word of God is living and you'll discover something new each and every time. 7-week course, starts in 2 weeks. We look at some foundational principles, topics, the Bible, prayer, fellowship, evangelism, and the Lordship of Jesus Christ. And we use it with a workbook, free of charge, but the only resource we use is this. We do it in a relational way, small group way. It's going to be a lot of fun, 7 weeks. It ends on November 5th. Childcare will be provided. I'll be over there in just a few minutes if you'd like to come sign up and talk more about it, and then I'll be available for the next couple of weeks to answer all your questions. Thanks so much.
Excellent, excellent. Thanks, Max. Before you leave, I have one more thing for you. All right, so Max will be in Missio Day. He's doing the other 10-minute party this morning, so in the coffee shop, go see him. If you have questions, sign up and whatnot. And their class is, your class is going to meet in room 3 primarily in the kind of breakout. And there is childcare up to a certain age, so feel free to see that on the sign-up that you will see here and with Joel's class with Kingdom Life. This is just, we're going to give you a kind of a shot across the bow. The staff got together this last week or two as Hurricane Harvey was kind of approaching and making its devastation happening. Little did we know about Irma at the point. And the staff all walked in one day and said, we need to be doing something about relief for Harvey. So that is our focal point at this moment. And we started praying as a staff and talking names. And Max got this guy right here is going to take a role. Now he's going to teach his class. We actually approached Max if he would be willing to be the key leader to develop a relief team to respond to Hurricane Harvey. Now, we don't have, that was this last week we've been talking. He and his wife prayed about it, absolutely said yes. And so we don't have a whole lot more than that, other than I want you to see his face, I want you to know his name, and pray for him as we try to figure out how do we come alongside to partner physically, financially, certainly, and prayerfully with helping the folks that are truly in need, which are many, certainly, because of Hurricane Harvey. We'll see what God's doing with that, but we just want to get to, and as soon as we get more information, as we get kind of next steps, Max, I'm sure, will be bringing that to us, and we'll be able to communicate that, okay? So be praying for Max, pray for this church, see what God does with that. All right, I'll let you go, brother. Lastly, let me invite our chairman, Rick Bixman, to come on up. Rick just wants to give you a brief update on behalf of the elder team this morning.
Thank you very much. you'll find in your folders that you have out here, this is a financial report. It's an update. It includes August. So I ask every one of you, please, please, take this out and look at it and be familiar with it. We want to thank you, the elders want to thank you for all the faithful givers in the church. We're praying for a solid September. As you look at this, this is through August. So we're praying for a solid September, and we're asking for an additional $20,000, $21,000. You'll see that number on that blue report. But we're asking for that, asking for you to give that above and beyond your normal tithes, and if the Lord leads you to do that. So please go to the Lord, seek the Lord's guidance, and follow the Lord. we're trying to get back to where we were last September. So that would put us back there financially. And after the congregational meeting, we've enjoyed meeting with several people, couples and families and individuals after that meeting. And we appreciate all the feedback we've gotten. We've listened to you. We hope to have many more discussions. So I'd like to encourage anybody, if you have any questions following our meeting, any questions that you might have, please find an elder or elders, and we'd be happy to meet with you and have that conversation. So please don't stand back and be afraid to do that. Thank you.
Absolutely. Thank you, Rick. Yeah, so the elders will be bringing certainly something more as a result of the annual meeting back in the time ahead. But again, as Rick is saying, make sure to see them if you have any questions or comments, anything beyond that. August, again, like you said, was not what we have been experiencing. So we want to finish the year at least on balance with where we started the year. So we need to see about a $20,000, $21,000 uptick. So that's above and beyond what you may have dedicated on your faith promise card. And so if God has blessed you above and beyond, would you prayerfully consider putting that in the joy box as a blessing gift above and beyond in September so we can get at least back up to where we were. So, all right, time for benediction. Comes out of Jude. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, Jesus Christ, our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all times, now and forevermore. Amen. You are dismissed. Remember the 10-minute parties this morning. Enjoy your fellowship time.